This is an historic week in the Senate because we've been engaged in a debate for weeks about what to do about health care in America. The Senate, of course, is under the majority control of the Republicans, as the House of Representatives is, and of course with the Republican president. They all came to Washington at the beginning of this year and said the first thing we want to do is to repeal Obamacare. We've said it for 6 years, we're finally going to do it. We're going to get rid of Obamacare, the Affordable Care Act, once and for all. And they set out to do it in a variety of ways. President Trump, his first executive order to the agencies of the federal government, said do everything you can to discourage Obamacare. And he turned around and did just that. His agency stopped advertising for people to sign up for Obamacare. They were determined to put an end to it. And in the House of Representatives, they took a step beyond that. They introduced legislation to repeal it and replace it, but what they replaced it with was a disaster. The Congressional Budget Office took a look at the Republican repeal plan in the House and said it will cost America 24 million people will lose their health insurance. And beyond that, they talked about the changes that would take place in health insurance policies with the Republican repeal plan. It passed the House by 4 votes, which meant that if two Republican members, and only Republicans voted for it, if two Republican members had voted the other way, it wouldn't have passed. It was that close. Then it was sent over to the Senate, and it was up to the Senate Republicans to decide what they would do with this bill and what they would do with the repeal of Obamacare. They spent many weeks in conversation and discussion about what they might do. 13 members, Republican senators, sat in private rooms and talked about what they would do to replace Obamacare. And finally, they reported a bill. It turns out that their bill was an improvement over the House bill. The House bill eliminated health insurance for 24 million Americans. The Senate bill eliminated health insurance for 23 million Americans. But still, when you look at it, it's a horrible thing. In my state of Illinois, a million people in my state would have lost health insurance with either the House or Senate Republican bills. And it's the reason why there's been resistance in my state to this Republican effort from the start. You would expect it on a political basis. Sure, the Democrats will oppose the Republicans on issues, but this went beyond it. There wasn't a single medical advocacy group in the United States that supported what the Republicans were doing. Not one. The Hospital Association across America, the Medical Society of Doctors, the nurses, the pediatricians, they all opposed what the Republicans set out to do. And so when it looked like there were problems in passing one version of the Senate Republican repeal bill, they sat down to rewrite it. And as they sat down to rewrite it, they got into deeper water and bigger problems. Senator Cruz, the junior senator from Texas, said, well, one way to bring down the cost of health insurance is to take out some of the protections of a health insurance policy. We can get premiums down pretty low if we take away the protections of a health insurance policy that are in the Affordable Care Act. That was his proposal. Just this weekend, Blue Cross Blue Shield and the major health insurance industry said, this will be a disaster. If you have some people buying real insurance and real protection, and others paying rock bottom premiums for little or no coverage, you're going to create two classes of Americans, and you're going to see premiums going through the roof for those who are buying full coverage policies. They came out against the Cruz proposal. Well, this week, we returned to face the votes. We were supposed to be voting today, a vote on whether or not to repeal Obamacare. As of last night, things started changing here. Two Republican senators joined two others and said they were opposing the effort. And so the Republican majority did not have the votes it needed to go forward. They said, well, at least we'll vote on repealing Obamacare. Three Republican senators have announced, as of today, that voting for simple repeal is something that they won't do. Many of them make the argument that just repealing Obamacare without replacing it is irresponsible. They're right. If you don't like the current system, I believe you're duty-bound as a senator or congressman to come up with a better idea, something that serves America better. They've been unable to reach that point. So where are we? At this moment, we're at a standstill. The Republican efforts to repeal and replace have stopped as of this moment. There may be a vote, an official vote this week. I don't know. That's up to Senator McConnell and his, as a Republican leader. But it appears that there is no plan coming out of the Republican side to replace the Affordable Care Act. Now, I'm proud to have voted for it. I voted for it for very simple reasons. When it comes to health insurance, I believe that's one of the basics in life. I'm one of those politicians that believes health care is a right, just like police and fire protection. It should be part of who we are in America. I don't believe it's just a question of how rich you are, how lucky you are, as to whether you have health insurance in this country. We can do better as a nation, and the Affordable Care Act set out to do that. We reduced the number of uninsured Americans with Obamacare, when we passed it 6 years ago, by 50%. We reduced by half the uninsured people living in my state of Illinois. Many of them went to the insurance exchanges, bought private health insurance. If they had lower incomes, they got subsidies to help pay the premiums. Others picked up Medicaid coverage as their health insurance. It was significant. I ran into people all across my state, from Chicago to downstate, who had never had health insurance one day in their lives. These are not lazy people. These are hardworking people who happen to have the kind of jobs that didn't offer health insurance. Ray Romanowski, big Polish fella, guitarist and musician up in Chicago. Senator, I've never had health insurance. I'm a musician. Nobody was ever going to provide me with health insurance. But he says, lucky I have it now, because I've been diagnosed with diabetes. I'm in my 60s, and I have, through the Affordable Care Act, health insurance through Medicaid. Similar story, almost identical story, in deep southern Illinois. Judy, who works as a hospitality hostess in a local motel, she's the one who greets you with a smile when you come in for that free breakfast. Judy's 62 years of age, never had health insurance one day in her life. She holds down two and three jobs at a time. The only health insurance she ever had is what she has now, under Medicaid. What's going to happen to those people if we eliminate Medicaid coverage, which the proposals before us suggested, or cut back dramatically in Medicaid coverage? Those two people, Ray, Judy, are still going to face health challenges. They're still going to get sick and go to the hospital, but they don't have health insurance. Will the hospital treat them? Yes. What'll happen to their bills? Their costs will be passed on to everyone else. That's the way it used to be done. What we have learned this week in Washington, in this national healthcare debate, is there is, of course, concerns about whether the current healthcare system is what it should be, and I think it could be improved. But we've learned one basic thing. We're not going back. We're not going back to the days when the health insurance companies could deny coverage to you or your family because of a pre-existing condition. We're not going back to the days where they put a limit on how much they would pay on your health insurance plan. Remember when you first realized that a $100,000 limit wasn't worth that much if you had a serious diagnosis or a serious accident? We're not going back to the days when that health insurance plan literally expired in coverage, forcing you and your family into bankruptcy over medical bills. We're not going back to the day when families couldn't cover their kids coming out of college. The Affordable Care Act said you can keep your child on your health insurance plan as a family until they reach the age of 26. Those of us who've had kids who graduated college realize that they don't always get a great job right off the bat. Some of them start as interns or part-time workers, and they don't have health insurance. Well, they now know that they have the peace of mind of the family health insurance plan. We want to make sure we protect that. We're not going back to the day when those young people had no coverage at a critical moment in their lives. And we're not going back to the day when we allow these insurance companies to charge whatever premiums they wish. We put provisions in the law that limit the premiums that can be charged on Americans, to limit the profits that are taken out of health insurance companies. Those were moves that had to be made to protect innocent American families who unfortunately are struggling with medical bills before this bill passed, or this law passed, and now at least have some chance of paying for them. So what we learned in the course of this national debate is significant. We learned that if you put up a proposal, as the Republicans did in the House and the Senate, that takes health insurance away from over 20 million Americans, you've got a problem. People are going to push back and say that isn't fair to take away health insurance and the protection and peace of mind that comes with it. If you come up with a plan that ends up dramatically cutting back on Medicaid, you're going to get a lot of people who are concerned about it. The Medicaid program, as we know it across America, does many significant things. One half of the babies born in my state of Illinois are covered by Medicaid. Mom and her prenatal care, the delivery of the baby, and the caring for mom and the child afterward, covered by Medicaid. If you make a cut in the reimbursement for Medicaid, you endanger that basic treatment so that you can have that healthy baby. The second thing we know is that Medicaid is critical for people with disabilities. I met a mother in Champaign, Illinois, and she came up and told me she has a 23-year-old autistic son. It's been a struggle for her and her family, but now he has a somewhat independent life. She said, "Senator, you take away Medicaid insurance from him, I've got to put him in some institutional program that I cannot afford. There's nowhere to turn." I also want to remind people that Medicaid pays school districts to take care of kids with special education needs, transportation, counselors, even feeding tubes for the severely disabled. That's what's an important part of Medicaid. But I haven't touched on the most expensive part of the Medicaid program in America. The most expensive part is for those who are in nursing homes, those who are older Americans and need Medicaid to get by. They have Social Security, they have Medicare, but they need Medicaid. If you cut back on Medicaid, as proposed by the Republicans in both the House and the Senate, who takes care of these elderly folks who are in a situation where they've exhausted their savings? Do they move back in with a family? Sometimes that's not even possible, but that's one of the prospects faced. So what we need to do is to accept the obvious. We have reached an important political milestone here, where the Republicans don't have the vote to move forward, but we'd still have the challenge of the current system. I was proud to vote for it, but it is far from perfect. The current healthcare system in America, the Affordable Care Act, needs help, needs changes. We need to do it. We ought to just surprise the heck out of America by working together, both political parties, to solve the problems. And let's identify a few of the most obvious problems. Number one, the Affordable Care Act in America today does not address the cost of prescription drugs. You ask a health insurance company, what's driving the cost of premiums? Prescription drugs. Did you ever notice when you turn on the television certain times of the day, it's all about drugs? It's all about new drugs, things that you can hardly pronounce. These new drugs are being advertised on television time and again, and then a 2 or 3 minute disclaimer, be careful, if you take this drug, you might die. Be sure and tell your doctor if you've ever had a liver transplant. I listen to all these warnings, and I'm thinking, this is being sold in advertising for the general population? Did you know that there are only 3 countries in the world that allow television advertising of prescription drugs? The United States, New Zealand, and Brazil. Why do the pharmaceutical companies advertise drugs on televisions? Certainly, if you want to inform a doctor about a new drug, you wouldn't buy a television ad, would you? The reason they're on television is so that we, as individual consumers and patients, will walk into that doctor's office and say, "Doctor, it took me 5 times, but I finally figured out how to spell Xarelto, and I want Xarelto as my blood thinner." And the doctor has a choice then. He or she can explain to you, you may not need Xarelto, there's a cheaper version of blood thinner, or this isn't the one that really fits your needs in this circumstance. Doctors don't do that. Many of them just write out the prescription. That's why the television advertising is taking place, to convince the consumer who asks the doctor, who ends up with the high-priced drug being scripted for them. That's the reality of why the cost of healthcare keep going up. What does the Affordable Care Act do about that? Nothing. Nothing when it comes to the cost of prescription drugs. I want these drug companies to make a profit. Don't get me wrong. If they're profitable, looking for new cures, that's the way it should be. But when they charge through the roof and double and triple the cost of these pharmaceutical drugs, that's not fair. It's not fair to consumers, and it's not fair to taxpayers. Think about the fact that many of the same drugs, exactly the same drugs, made in the United States are sold for a fraction of what we charge in the United States in other countries. Even in Canada, they charge about a half or a third for many of the most popular drugs because the Canadian government said to the drug companies in America, we're drawing the line. We're not going to let you charge anything you want to charge. Why don't we do something in America to protect consumers? Why don't we at least inform people when pharmaceutical companies are overcharging so that we can put some pressure on them to stop? That's part of the change of the Affordable Care Act that I think will save us money and in the same time deal with an issue that most Americans really are concerned about. We also should be concerned about the fact that when it comes to the individual health insurance market, that's where most of the problems are. 6% of the American population buying health insurance through the exchanges, half of them have to pay the full premium, and some of those premiums go through the roof. Why? Because the people who are buying this insurance are usually people with a history, a medical history, or they're older folks, and they want to have the peace of mind of coverage. The healthy younger folks aren't buying. As a result, the insurance risk pool gets pretty expensive when it comes to premiums. We need to fix that, and we can fix that. That's another thing we should come together as Democrats and Republicans to try to achieve. For those who say, well, I promised my entire political career that I couldn't wait for the day to come forward and vote to repeal Obamacare, I just want to tell them that they should be aware that when the Congressional Budget Office looked at the impact of just repealing the Affordable Care Act and not replacing it, they said the following. This would force more insurance companies to leave the market immediately. It would increase premiums by 20% a year and double the price of premiums over 10 years, and it would take health insurance away from 32 million people. So taking that vote just to repeal the Affordable Care Act may be earn you a cheer at some political rally, but it's not responsible. It's not good. It raises the cost of health insurance for families across our country if we just repeal and don't replace, and it takes health insurance away from over 30 million people, according to the Congressional Budget Office. Better that we replace with something responsible, better that we take the current system and make it stronger. This has been an interesting debate. I've learned a lot in the course of this debate because I went and visited the hospitals of Illinois. The Illinois Hospital Association opposed the Republican plan in the House, opposed the proposal in the Senate. They said it would cost us 60,000 to 80,000 jobs in Illinois, and it would close down some hospitals we need in rural parts of our state, small town hospitals that are critically important. I don't want to see that happen. The people who live there don't want to see it happen, and you can't keep and attract good employers and good jobs if it does happen. And so I've worked with these hospital administrators and want to move forward with them with an alternative. I will close by saying this. It's interesting how many people say, I can't wait till I reach age 65 because I'll qualify for Medicare. Medicare doesn't discriminate based on pre-existing conditions and provides good health insurance for Americans, millions of Americans. It's an illustration and a lesson for us that if you have something that isn't driven by the profit motive that people trust, that has provided basic good care for Americans, good hospitals, and good doctors, that's what people are looking for, and why shouldn't they? That should be part of the American dream. It should be part of our right as Americans.